Good morning, I'm Mike Navalio.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman.
Join us as we give you the rundown of the news you need to know today. In the headlines, a group of martial law survivors asked the Philippine Supreme Court to disqualify presidential frontrunner Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. We speak with Karma's lawyer, attorney Howard Calleja, later on the program.
The Philippine full body officially proclaims 12 new senators of the country.
Medical workers and senior citizens in the Philippines can now get a second COVID-19 booster shot.
And a Russian soldier pleads guilty to killing a Ukrainian civilian in the first war crimes trial since Moscow's invasion of Kyiv.
Thank you for joining us. The 12 winning senatorial bets for the May 9 elections have now been proclaimed. Each of them had their moment on the PICC stage Wednesday afternoon to receive their certifications and have their hands raised by the poll commissioners. Topping the senatorial race was actor and political rookie Robin Padilla, followed by returning Senator Lorin Legarda and TV personality Rafi Tulfo.
Ang akin pong pagkapanalo ay isa pong simbolo ng pagkakaisa ng mga Muslim at Kristiyano. Halos umabot po ang 30 taon. Wala pong Muslim na naging senador.
Rounding out the so-called Magic 12, re-electionist Sherwin Gatchalian, Francis Cheese Escudero, Mark Villar, Alan Peter Cayetano, Miguel Zubiri, Joel Villanueva, JV Ejercito, Lone Opposition Senator Risa Ontiveros, and Jingoy Estrada.
At asahan po ninyo, sa loob ng 6 na taon, ang aking mga ipinangako sa taong bayan noong panahon ng kampanya, lalong-lalo na po ang pagbibigay ng trabaho sa ating mga Pilipino na walang trabaho ay maisa sa kotoparan.
A strong, independent Senate that will help Malacanang when it needs help, but will also correct and fiscalize when they have to be told that something is wrong, is what our country needs now.
Senator Coco Pimentel eyeing to lead the upper chamber's minority bloc. Pimentel says he will ensure the Senate will not become a rubber stamp of the next administration. Pimentel, Senate President in the first 3 years of the Duterte administration.
He later had a fallout with President Rodrigo Duterte after the ruling party PDP Laban, of which both are members, was split into two factions during the elections. Pimentel now asserts he's qualified to lead the Senate minority bloc.
Siguro, ayaw po kay Risa, pero mag-uusap din kami ni Risa. Alam naman din ni Risa na una sa lahat, abogado ako. Number two, siyempre Senate rules are involved. So naging Senate President din naman ako. So I dealt with the Senate rules. And then number three, mas matanda ako sa kanya. Dagdag mo na yun.
Meanwhile, Senator Aimee Marcos and returning Senator Lorin Legarda are said to be after the chamber's number two post. Senator Sonny Angara says both expressed interest to become Senate President pro tempore in the 19th Congress.
I think there are a number of our colleagues who have expressed preference for that. No, I think si Sen Aimee said she wanted that initially. Then si Sen Lorin also said she's interested in that position. So pag-usapan pa siguro sino yung nararapat dyan sa position na yan.
Several incidents of vote buying during the Philippines' May 9 polls are reported by state agencies in the provinces. But as Nico Bawa tells us, witnesses are afraid to speak out.
Agents of NBI Bulacan responded to a complaint of vote buying in a candidate's house. But when they arrived, locals started to flee. The candidate's staff denied they were buying votes and explained that their poll watchers were having a meeting. Since there is nothing illegal in hiring numerous poll watchers and it's not covered under vote buying, there was no basis to investigate.
Kung tutusin, yung mga poll watchers, Siyempre pagka binayaran mo yan, as poll watchers, sasabihin yan sa mga magulang yan na sinuportahan tayo ni Mayor ganito, kinuha po akong poll watcher. Siyempre magkakasimpatsya ang isang buong pamilya niyan.
According to the COMELEC and NBI, it's difficult to prove vote buying without a witness. It's also not easy to submit in court stolen videos of vote buying. Complainants have to make an affidavit about an offer to buy their vote so that the buyer can be entrapped and charged.
Otherwise, when you know lodge a complaint affidavit-wise, it will be he said, she said. Sinabi niya, nagbo-vote buying ako, sinabi ko hindi.
Another problem with vote buying cases are complainants who lose interest in their complaint after the elections. While the NBI monitored different incidences of vote buying in different provinces, nobody was charged. That's aside from candidates giving money to fellow candidates.
I do not want to name names, pero nangyari to. Bawat mayor, binigyan. Bawat konsyel, binigyan. Hindi naman dinala. Technically, estafa that cannot be complained.
According to the NBI, as much as 7,000 pesos were given by some candidates to each voter. Alias Meli admitted that she received 500 pesos from her mayor but argued that she really intended to vote for that candidate anyway. She says it's common practice in their area for candidates to have counter offers for vote buying until polling centers close.
Ako nakuha doon sa isang mayor, 2,000. Nakuha doon sa isang, 1,500. Tapos, 2,000. Eh, sabi ko, ang lalaki. Sabi, ikaw eh, ayoko. Kasi, hindi ko kasi gagawin yung pagkapera na. Para bang natatakot akong sumubok.
Some candidates in other positions also buy votes separately. If a family has several voters, they can collect more money.
Na yung 5,000, maglakad-lag ka nga kung makakakita ka ng ganun kalaki. Sandali lang, nakakuha ka na agad-agad. Kaya yun ang inano namin.
The COMELEC cannot start its investigation on vote-buying complaints due to the lack of witnesses. Anti-Vote-Buying Task Force Contra Bigay says they have received 1,000 complaints via email and FB Messenger, but all the complaints are allegations without enough evidence. Currently, they are studying 49 complaints which have attached pieces of evidence. The NBI is now consolidating its report on election monitoring in the provinces.
Some NBI officials think that there should be a discussion on electoral reforms so that issues like vote buying and selling can be effectively addressed in the succeeding elections. Nico Bawa, ABS-CBN News.
Another group asked the Philippine Supreme Court to block the looming electoral victory of presidential frontrunner Bongbong Marcos. A petition for certiorari was filed by the group Karma, or the campaign against the return of the Marcoses and martial law. It claims the Election Commission gravely abused its discretion when it junked the group's disqualification case against Marcos. Karma also asked the High Court to issue an injunction stopping Congress from canvassing the votes for Marcos. The petitioners want Marcos's rival, Vice President Leni Robredo, to be declared as president. They claim she's the candidate with the most number of supposedly valid votes. Karma had sought to disqualify Marcos on the basis of his 1995 tax conviction, but COMELEC affirmed its decision to dismiss the case last week. A spokesperson for Marcos says that while it's understandable the petitioners want to exhaust all legal remedies, their chances for success are slim. Joining us this morning is Attorney Howard Calieja, the lawyer of Karma. Good morning, Attorney Calieja. Welcome back to the program.
Good morning, Mike. Good morning, Mickey. Good morning to all your televiewers. Magandang umaga po.
All right, Attorney Calieja, there's been a lot of discussions already on the grounds you raised for disqualifying presumptive President Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. For instance, the issues of perpetual disqualification, crimes involving moral turpitude, and the jail sentence that should have exceeded 18 months, according to your argument. All of these are grounds for disqualification. But the COMELEC has already ruled on these issues twice. Are you confident that the Supreme Court will have a different appreciation of the issues this time around?
Yes, Mike, we're confident that the Supreme Court would finally put an end to the matter. And hopefully, we are very prayerful and hopeful that the Supreme Court will see it properly, no, the legal and the right way of interpreting the sections or the laws that we cited for this case.
Mm-hmm. Now, let's try to go through them one by one, Attorney Calieja. On the ground of perpetual disqualification, the COMELEC said the amendment to the tax code imposing the accessory penalty of perpetual disqualification only took effect on January 1, 1986. If at all, that only applies to the 1985 filing. But Mr. Marcos was already in exile when the filing became due in March 1986. You're saying non-filing of ITR is a continuing offense? This is probably the first time you're hearing this argument.
Number one, Mike, we contend that he was still a public servant in March 1986. Who was deposed then was Ferdinand Marcos Sr., not Jr., the president, and not the governor. He was governor of Ilocos Norte at that time, number one. And as you said, he was supposed to file on March 15, 1986, which to our mind, he has never resigned. So he is still the governor at that time. If we look at it also, our theory, as you said, it is a continuing crime. Because if you look at it, even until the time that he was convicted in the RTC in 1995, he was a sitting congressman. Also, the time that he was given a notice when he returned from exile in 1991 or 1992, he was a congressman from 92 to 95. So put it this way, Mike, all this time from 1986 to the time up to now, he is still paying or he is still being imposed surcharges and penalties to the non-filing of his taxes. Meaning, taun-taun po yan na meron siyang pagkakasala. Dahil, why are you putting penalties and surcharges kung hindi naman siya nagkakasala? Ibig sabihin, he knows that there is a crime. He knows that there's an action that he has to do, but he refuses to do it even until the time that, until now, that he might be proclaimed president because he still hasn't paid his dues or his penalty to the crime.
Attorney, but the non-payment of penalties or the dues might also apply not just to other continuing offenses, but also to all other crimes. So how is non-filing of ITR a continuing offense? And are you saying this for the entire period, 1982 to 1985?
Yes, because we are saying, Mike, that if you did not pay, you have a continuing obligation to pay, correct? Mm-hmm. So if you have a continuing obligation to pay, and then the notice has been given to you, then of course, you are in continuing violation of that act. You cannot say that you violated it just in 1986 because if you did not pay it continually, of course, as we said, that you are also imposed surcharges and penalties, which means that you are still in a continuous violation of that act or the non-performance of that act, which is the non-payment of taxes. Also, as I said, we have to remind the Supreme Court that in 1986, he did not resign. He is still a public servant. So we feel that on two counts, number one, he was a public servant on the time of the supposed filing on March, and also on the continuing non-filing despite due notice and despite proper conviction in the RTC, that he still refuses to pay at that time. He was clearly a public servant, being a congressman of Ilocos Norte.
Just on this topic, Attorney Calieja, if by that argument, are we also saying that estafa can also be considered a continuing crime if you refuse to pay it up to the last minute?
No, because estafa is the act of fraud.
Mm-hmm.
So fraud happened at a certain time. But mm-hmm. there's no fraud in the non-payment of taxes. And the non-payment of taxes is a, as I said, demanded from you yearly. Even if those that have not been paid, they are still deemed demandable at that time, due and demandable at any time mm-hmm. after the April 15 or March 15 deadline of that certain year. So that due and demandable continues in the same light that if you refuse to pay, then you continually refuse to avoid or violate the tax code.
Mm-hmm. You also accused COMELEC of making an excuse for Mr. Marcos's non-filing of ITRs by citing abandonment of his office as governor. Explain this to us a bit more. Why is this grave abuse of discretion on the part of COMELEC?
Yes, because we said that COMELEC abandoned the position But to us, as I said, even if he abandoned the position, you have to look at that. Even in Hawaii at that time, if he abandoned the position, he could have paid his taxes in the consulate of Hawaii. Also, abandonment is intent of the mind, no? It is not something that Comelec can say as a certainty or sorry, as a certain fact. So we are saying that he continues to serve as one even if he left for Hawaii at in February of 1986.
Mm-hmm. Now, Comelec says nothing was written in the Court of Appeals decision, which became final, about any jail term for Mr. Marcos. So how will you convince the Supreme Court he should have been sentenced to imprisonment beyond 18 months so as to be disqualified from running for public office?
Well, the jail term, we are saying that the imposition of the penalty of the Court of Appeals is invalid. That's what we're saying, that by taking out the jail term, they abused their discretion. And that's why we are citing that with Comelec. But of course, Comelec, again, did not cite that, meaning they felt that it is within the jurisdiction of the Court of Appeals to amend the decision from imprisonment and fine to only fine at this point in time. So that's why we are, again, bringing it up an issue. It is a legal issue that we felt that was a abuse of discretion, both on the Court of Appeals and of the Comelec when it decided to decide in our favor for the jail term, for the issue of the jail term for Marcos at that time.
And just to be sure, you're saying that the CA decision is void as a whole or just void on that aspect for not imposing a jail term?
For not imposing a jail term, we felt that the CA decision is void and that they should revert back to the RTC decision, which is the decision should be controllable, which gives a 3 year per count, actually per conviction for Marcos Jr., I think, at that time. So that would be.
And that was a tax evasion conviction, right? The RTC.
Tax evasion and tax non-payment of taxes both were taken down. So that's why we're saying it should not only be a fine, it should be both a imprisonment and fine.
All right. Now, on the issue of moral turpitude, the Comelec went as far as saying there's nothing inherently wrong about the non-filing of ITRs and there's no fraud involved. But you're saying crimes involving moral turpitude do not always involve mala in se offenses and fraud. Let's try to unpack this for the viewers. When you say mala in se, what do you mean by this?
Well, we're saying that they're saying that moral turpitude should be those that are just violative in fact, no? Violative without a law saying that it is a violation, or without a decree, let's say murder, mala in se, that's for example. But let's say carrying of gun is not specifically prohibited, but if there is a law that says it is prohibited. So just like here, non-payment of taxes, it's not really, if there was no law saying it, so there is no violation.
You mean non-filing of ITRs? You mean non-filing of ITRs?
Yeah, non-filing of ITRs. But the law specifically says that there is a violation if you did not file the ITR. But what we are saying is that moral turpitude, even though if it is not mala in se, even though if it is imposed by law, it is still going to the character of the individual, because moral turpitude goes to the character of the person involved, so, and of the crime. So we would see here the character of Bongbong Marcos Jr., of the character of those that are not paying the ITR, that the lifeblood of the country or the sustenance of the country remains basically with the payment of taxes. And if you don't pay taxes, then it is detrimental to the nation. And also, you would see that the character of Bongbong Marcos not only did not pay tax, but continuously refuses to pay and continuously refuses to recognize our laws and the payment of also his penalties. So there you'd see the character of Bongbong Marcos to avoid and not to follow the laws. That's why we're calling it part of moral turpitude.
One big question you raised is, can the Supreme Court proclaim Vice President Lenny Robredo, who in your view, the candidate with the highest number of valid votes, as the winner of this year's polls in a disqualification case? Because most legal experts, even Comelec Commissioner George Garcia at one point said, the second placer only gets to be elected winner in a cancellation of COC case. But in this case, a disqualification case, if a front runner is disqualified after election, succession kicks in. So that means the duly elected vice president. Do you think otherwise? Why?
Yes, there is already a jurisprudence given here, I think back in 2013, that a disqualified candidate, is if the disqualification arises prior or is present prior to the filing of the certificate of canvass, the certificate of canvass is deemed null and void, and thus there was no candidate to speak of. So in this case, Bongbong Marcos Jr., Ferdinand Marcos Jr., his disqualification was present, is present prior to filing, is still present up to today. So he's perpetually disqualified. So we're saying that there was no candidate to speak of at the very start. So that his votes are stray and that the only person that had the valid votes is Lenny Robredo. Secondly, if you look at the Constitution, it is very clear that the process of succession, the vice president or the Senate president or the Speaker of the House, as it may be, depends on the process of succession, only replaces when there is death, this resignation, and or I think disability is the other one. But there was no mention of disqualification because at the very start, there should be replacing a duly elected president. If you are disqualified, you are never and will never be a duly elected president from the very start. So that would not cure, even your oath will not cure your being a president or a being a valid president. That's why we're saying it is very clear. Disqualification is not an issue of succession. Even if you look at the, as I said, even if you look at the Constitution, it is not among the grounds for one to step into the shoes of the presidency. And as I said, since the disqualification was present at the start, there was no person who was a candidate, thus no votes can be credited to him or her during the election.
So Attorney Calia, you're saying that it's not so much the remedy involved, whether it's cancellation of COC or disqualification, that's determinative of the outcome, but whether the ineligibility was present at the time of a filing of COC. Is that the more determinative factor?
Yes, I think that is how you would like to look at it. Because if I think there were cases before, but the disqualification was during the time of the candidacy or during the time of election. So that is a different issue. What I'm saying, similar, I forgot the name, but similar to the 2013 case, the disqualification was prior or was present prior to the filing of the candidacy. So that's why, as you said, the determinative factor is that when you are disqualified or when the issue of disqualification was present prior to your filing of candidacy, you were never a valid candidate to speak of, thus your votes were never valid and stray. And the one that has the second or the one that has a highest valid number of votes should be declared the winner or the president in this case.
Attorney Calia, will it matter if, for instance, by next week, the National Board of Canvassers convene and they will proclaim as president, presumptive president, Bongbong Marcos? Will it matter if there's already a proclamation or if he has already taken or assumed office? Because as we know, the Supreme Court is now in a recess and they will only convene in June. So if that happens, there's a proclamation, will it matter now that he has been proclaimed?
That's why, kaya nga, Mike, no, we filed a prayer for TRO and preliminary injunction. We are praying that hopefully the Supreme Court will look at this with urgency. Sana po yung ating mga maestrado. I would also like to congratulate Justin Singh, who was just took her oath as the 15th Supreme Court Justice. So that completes them now. So, sana po, tingnan nila ito ng mabilis at sana po pakinggan natin para nga it would also keep a put a closure into the case. But in any case, if there was a proclamation, as I said, it would not matter because he's still a disqualified candidate and he is still perpetually disqualified to hold public office. So yung perpetual disqualification to hold public office, even after proclamation, even after oath, that po does not take that out that consequence or that penalty. So it is also, he cannot also hide under the immunity as president because he was never a valid candidate and a valid president to begin with.
Attorney Calia, the case that you're citing, Makiling, in 2013.
Yes, 2013, yes.
Yes, that involves a mayor, right? That involves a mayor. So, but now this case involves the president, an impeachable officer who can only be removed through quo warranto or impeachment once he gets proclaimed and once he sits in office. So can this disqualification case be another way of removing a sitting president, or will there be a requirement for an impeachment at the House of Representatives or at least a quo warranto proceeding before the Supreme Court?
Yeah, it can be after the oath, it can be shifted to a quo warranto proceeding, but not an impeachment case because that would be for Congress to decide. So that's why we're hoping that it should be decided prior to any oath. But if not, we're also studying maybe retaining the case or shifting it to a quo warranto proceeding. Just like to clarify, in the Makiling case in 2013, the second place or the one with the highest number of votes was the one declared mayor, not the vice mayor. So they're saying that similar to that, the disqualification of the mayor, similarly here, the disqualification of the president calls for the proclamation of the second of the individual that has the highest number of valid votes.
But Attorney Calia, don't you think the overwhelming number of votes for Mr. Marcos, 31 million, will lead Supreme Court magistrates to say, the people have spoken, so let's respect the will of the electorate? That's the same line from the Marcos case.
Again, that is also a jurisprudence already decided back in our region in Sorsogon, the Raul Lee case, that Vox Populi is no longer applicable, but what is applicable is the rule of law. So what is the rule of law here is the imposition of the perpetual disqualification. So what is more important than any election, which to me is even questionable at this point in time, but academically be that as me, if you say that he won the election, we are saying that Vox Populi or the voice of the people is no longer a good law or a jurisprudence followed even by the Supreme Court, even by our law. So that would not put any bearing into the situation. Also that, as I said, if we question the election, then that would be another issue. But then again, we will just put our argument to the merits of the case, which we're saying that no matter if he was taken the oath or he has proclaimed, or no matter how many votes he allegedly has, the rule of law should remain supreme, which says that since he is a convict, since he has violated the tax laws, he is perpetually disqualified to hold any public office.
Now, lastly, Attorney Calia, why is it important for you and your clients who are martial law victims to pursue this case further?
Of course, this is a for the clients, sa pangalan na lang nila, di ba? This is a against the return of the Marcos regime. It is nothing personal to them against Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos, but it is also to them a recognition of history, a recognition of what happened during the martial law time, a recognition of the torture that they themselves personally bore, no? They personally took at that time. So it is important that we don't forget history. It's important there's no revisionism of history. And more so, whether or not they were victims, ang importante naman dito, Mike, meron tayong batas na pinanghahawakan. At yung batas na yan po, kahit na sino pa sila, it is just a matter of implementing it fairly, judiciously, and squarely to all of us. What we're saying is, we all pay our taxes. It doesn't matter who the petitioners are. It doesn't matter who the defendant or the respondent is. It matters that all of us pay taxes. And if we don't pay taxes, we must suffer the consequence. And one of the consequences therein is a perpetual disqualification. So be that as it may, Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos remains a convict and remains perpetually disqualified.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for joining us this morning, Attorney Howard Calia, lawyer for Karma.
Thank you. Thank you, Mike.
Meanwhile, Philippine poll watchdog PPCRV says election returns encoded by its volunteers still show a high match rate with the May 9th vote tally of the Election Commission. The Parish Pastoral Council for Responsible Voting reports a 98.88% match rate after encoding over 60,000 poll returns. It says 327 returns still have to be revalidated. Nearly 80,000 election returns out of the total 107,000 are now with the PPCRV. Of that number, 55,000 are from Luzon, 16,000 are from the Visayas, while 7,000 are from Mindanao. Poll returns from overseas voters have yet to arrive.
Chinese President Xi Jinping holds a phone conversation Wednesday with leading Philippine presidential bet Bongbong Marcos. China's ambassador to the Philippines says President Xi once again congratulated Marcos on his electoral victory. The Chinese leader supposedly described Marcos as a builder, supporter, and promoter of the friendship between China and the Philippines. The two also talked about bilateral ties and regional development.
The incoming Philippine President's choice for Migrant Workers Department Chief admits her battle with cancer may affect her decision on whether to accept the post. Migrant Workers' Rights Advocate Susan Ople was diagnosed with stage 2 breast cancer in 2020. Ople had to undergo chemotherapy and PET scans.
That will be a lifelong concern. To be honest about it, whether I accept the job or I don't accept the job, sa akin kasi panata ko na yung to serve our OFWs in whatever capacity. So definitely it's a factor.
Ople says she wants to consult migrant worker groups and other stakeholders before making her decision. She reveals the offer to head the newly created Migrant Workers Department was made during a meeting with Marcos last Friday at his Makati City residence.
President Rodrigo Duterte expresses his gratitude to Filipinos who stayed loyal to him during his presidency. Duterte is preparing to step down from office on June 30. He spoke in Pasay City Wednesday during a convention of retail giant Pure Gold. Speaking at the event, Duterte also stressed the importance of small and medium-sized enterprises to the Philippine economy.
I am on my tail end sa presidency ko. Pero yung tumulong sa akin, nagsuporta all these years, at yung umintindi ng mga hangarin ko sa ating bayan, I would like to express my gratitude sa inyo. This administration has always recognized small and medium-sized enterprises as one of the backbones of our economy. With the countless jobs that SMEs produce for the country's growing labor force, the aid in our aim to utilize our people's talent and in our fight to reduce hunger and poverty.
Court of Appeals Justice Maria Filomena Singh is the newest member of the Philippine Supreme Court. This was confirmed by Executive Secretary Salvador Medialdea. Singh takes over the post vacated by retired Senior Associate Justice Estela Pelas Bernabe. Singh is the sister of health spokesperson Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergere. She was among the CA justices who dissented in the January 2018 ruling of the CA ordering the release of ex-Palawan Governor Joel Reyes. He was suspected of killing broadcaster environmentalist Jerry Ortega in 2011.
Philippine media personality Ramon Tulfo arrested on cyber libel charges. An arrest warrant for Tulfo was issued Wednesday by a Manila court, but details of the complaint remain unavailable. The Manila police said a certain attorney, Leon Cruz, who represented the unnamed complainant, sought the help of the police for Tulfo's arrest. According to Tulfo, the charges stem from his failure to attend court proceedings. His lawyer says they will file an urgent motion to lift the arrest warrant against the media man. Tulfo is detained at the Manila Police District Headquarters.
I just missed one or two hearings.
Because
I was in China as a special envoy. Hindi naman ako, I didn't mean to disrespect the court, pero hindi ko na, nakaligtaan ko lang. Kasalanan ko, nakaligtaan ko lang yun. Kasi wala naman akong balak na hindi, this job-related itong mga kasong ito.
And we are taking a quick break. Up ahead, medical workers and senior citizens in the Philippines can now get a second COVID-19 booster shot.
And we speak with Iloilo City Mayor Jerry Treñas about the COVID situation in the city following the detection of a new Omicron subvariant. These and more when the rundown returns. Stay tuned.
Welcome back to the rundown. The headlines across the web. Inquirer's banner story online, the spike in demand for illegal drugs as COVID curbs loosen. Philippine Star's top story, the rise in the number of poor Filipino families based on an SWS survey. The uptick in COVID cases in seven cities in Metro Manila is Manila Bulletin's headline. Topping Jimmy News' website, the Agriculture Department warning of a food crisis. And CNN Philippines' banner story, the Labor Department saying more regions will be seeing wage hikes.
Health workers and senior citizens in the Philippines are now allowed to get a second COVID booster shot. The Health Department approved the additional doses of Pfizer and Moderna for the said groups on Wednesday. The new shot is to be taken at least 4 months after the initial booster dose. The approval also comes amid the confirmed local transmission of the BA2.12.1 Omicron subvariant. Presidential Advisor for Entrepreneurship Joey Concepcion pushing to have more people be allowed to receive a second booster shot.
We have a lot of vaccines and medyo matumal ang kumukuha ng mga bakuna ngayon, no? So if there are people who really want to take the booster shots, let's allow them. And we whatever is allowed, no? The immunocompromised, 60 years and above, dapat whoever gets into the LGU to get their bakuna, pasukin na, no? And hopefully the HTAC will reconsider, no, and maybe reconsider and maybe allow the 50 years and above. No?
Now, the mayor of Iloilo says the three cases of the new Omicron subvariant detected in the city have already tested negative for COVID. But were they able to stop the spread of the virus? Mayor Jerry Treñas now joins us live to talk about the COVID situation in Iloilo. Good morning, Mayor. Congratulations, first off, and thank you for always speaking to us.
Good morning. the Omicron subvariant, all have travel history, and they came from abroad. And we have tested all the close contacts, and they also tested negative. We are still waiting for some results for some of the close contacts. But in the meantime, I think all the close contacts tested negative. The problem is that they are sending specimen to the genome center, but it takes so long for the genome center to send back the results. These persons with the Omicron subvariants came in last March, and the results of the genome sequencing only came in this month, no? So it's taking so long.
And Mayor, these people who did contract the new subvariant of Omicron, how were they when they still had the virus? Were they asymptomatic? Did they have serious symptoms?
All the close contacts are all asymptomatic.
That's good to know. And what is Iloilo then now doing as preparation for this to prevent community transmission, you know, of this variant? Any changing of protocols in place?
Well, as long as we open the community, as long as we open all the flights coming in from all places, I think there is always the possibility that those who are infected with Omicron sub-variants or the other variants will come in. But, you know, after so long, we have no choice. We really have to open up the economy. We have to go back to face-to-face classes. Our children are suffering so much because of the quality of education, even before this pandemic, and how much more today when classes are being held online and through modules, and the modules are being answered by the parents.
There's still that balance to think of, no? So, Mayor, how is your current COVID case count? Are you also seeing a rise in cases about a week after the polls?
The cases here are down. And, you know, I think we are among the very few cities all over the country that offers free RT-PCR tests. And sometimes we have 500 specimen, and most of the time we have zero cases. Today we have two cases. It's no longer an issue. Our vaccination rate is high. Our boosters, we are the highest in the region, about 38%. I am happy if they will now allow the senior citizens and all those who want to have second boosters to come in and have their boosters, because I see no reason why all the other persons who would like to have a second booster will not be allowed. We have so much vaccines now, and most of these vaccines are expiring.
Mayor, on another aspect, we know that Iloilo City is also one of the hardest hit by COVID in the past. Are you seeing normalcy return to your hospitals now in terms of manpower, equipment, and the like?
The hospitals are doing okay. We do not have a lot of patients right now. We were able to open a 70-bed modular field hospital, which is still open and has not accepted any patient at all, no, because of the high occupancy rate of our hospitals. Because, you know, Iloilo hospitals cater to patients coming from the whole region. So cases are low. Not only in Iloilo City, but in the whole region. I think vaccination has really helped a lot. Mm-hmm. And that is also the reason why I'm saying that we should allow everyone to have a second booster right now.
And Mayor, let's go back to the vaccination efforts. It's good to know that your vaccination rate is quite high. You're planning to ramp up your efforts for your COVID-19 booster program, right? How do you plan to go about this?
If the government will allow us to give second boosters now, the vaccines are readily available in our health centers. So it's in the communities right now. People can just walk to the health center and have their boosters.
All right. On that note, we continue hoping for the best. Thank you so much for always answering our call, Mayor Jerry. You stay safe.
Thank you, and nice to see you again.
And meanwhile, over in North Korea, Supreme Leader Kim Jong-un blames the negligence and laziness of state officials for the spiraling COVID outbreak in the country. That says the number of cases there crossed 1.7 million just a week after the country reported its first infections. Kim has ordered nationwide lockdowns and deployed the military after what he called a botched response to the outbreak. According to state media, nearly 3,000 military medics are taking part in a 24-hour operation to deliver medicines.
In other news, U.S. investigators believe the crashing of the China Eastern flight last March 21st that killed all of its 132 passengers was deliberately done by someone on board. The so-called black box flight data recorders had been sent to the U.S. for analysis. Citing people familiar with the probe, the Wall Street Journal reports the data had shown that someone had input orders to send the Boeing jet into a nosedive. U.S. officials believe their conclusion is backed up by the fact that Chinese investigators have so far not indicated any problems with the aircraft or flight controls that could have caused the crash. U.S. and Boeing officials, however, have declined to comment on the report.
A 21-year-old Russian soldier pleads guilty to killing a Ukrainian civilian in the first war crimes trial since Moscow's invasion of Kyiv. The soldier, who is expected to be the first of many prosecuted by Ukraine, admitted to shooting dead a 62-year-old man on a bicycle in the Sumy region 4 days into the invasion. He faces a life sentence after his guilty plea. Ukraine's prosecutor general says the trial sends a clear signal that every person who ordered or assisted in the commission of crimes in the country will not avoid responsibility. The International Criminal Court is also investigating Russia's alleged war crimes.
Let's now find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing today with our correspondent, Henny Espinosa.
Good morning, guys. Here are the latest stories making headlines in the Filipino community. We begin in Canada, where the Coalition for Leni Kiko Vancouver says many of their supporters are still in shock at the result of overseas voting for the May 9 Philippine presidential elections. Campaign organizer Amado Mercado shares that they are waiting for clarity on the alleged questionable pattern of vote margin between former Senator Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. and Vice President Leni Robredo in the precincts in Vancouver.
Gusto lang namin talagang naging malinis ang election, no, once and for all. Para kung talagang nanalo si Bongbong, we can concede, no, pero kung walang malinaw na sagot, we cannot concede.
The alleged perfectly linear trend in the voting was questioned by poll watchers and observers in the letter that they sent to the Philippine Consulate General in Vancouver. In response, Consul General Maria Angelita Austria explained that the roll was limited to ballot feeding. She assured them, though, that they have relayed the group's concerns to COMELEC. Meanwhile, after spending months on the campaign trail, VP Robredo is spending quality time with her youngest daughter, Jillian, by attending an important moment in her life, her graduation from one of the most prestigious universities in the U.S., the New York University. Jillian is graduating with a double degree in mathematics and economics. Robredo shared this photo of Jillian on social media, calling it a big day for her daughter. At the NYU Baccalaureate, Robredo posted that Jillian wore what matters most, a pendant containing her father's ashes and her graduation stole with the colors of the Philippine flag and her Rosas pin. Grammy-winning singer and songwriter Taylor Swift, who received an honorary degree, delivered the commencement speech for NYU's class of 2022.
I'm 90% sure the main reason I'm here is because I have a song called 22.
And finally, we go to Las Vegas, where just in time for National Nurses Week, hundreds of Filipino nurses and their guests celebrated 30 years of the Philippine Nurses Association of Nevada with a gala. More than 2 years since the pandemic, these medical frontliners were glad to gather on a momentous occasion with the theme, Pearls of Wisdom and Resilience.
You give so much of your heart and your soul to take care of the people that you don't even know. And especially this last 2 years of the pandemic, you were the heroes and still are the heroes of our times.
Through the years, the PNANV has helped nursing students through scholarships. The group has also raised money for victims of natural disasters in the Philippines. Members have also stood by each other in the fight against COVID-19.
And those were the latest headlines from North America. You can catch our stories online at news.abs-cbn.com/TFCnews and on the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel. Back to you guys for the rundown.
Thank you, Henny. Agriculture Secretary William Dar believes lowering rice prices to 20 pesos per kilo is possible in the next administration. That was promised by leading presidential candidate Bongbong Marcos during his campaign. But Dar says it won't be easy to achieve, as it would require bumping the agriculture budget and providing more aid to rice farmers.
We have really to see na yung pagbaba ng cost of production, bigyan natin ng additional budget ang LFA to the level of 30 billion. So dagdagan natin ng 23 billion kada taon para makasustain sila ng buffer stock ng 30 days. Now, what are the effects of that? They will maintain yung farm gate price from present to, you know, present price, farm gate price kayo na 19 pesos, pwede naman itas yan sa 20.
Russia's economic growth slows in the first quarter of the year as the initial impact of sanctions against President Vladimir Putin's invasion of Ukraine unfolds. The Russian economy expanded 3.5% in the first 3 months of 2022 after growing 5% in the previous quarter. It's also below the 3.7% growth forecast of economists. The first quarter is expected to be the last with sound growth as Russia takes a hit from sweeping sanctions for its February 24 invasion of Ukraine. Those sanctions, which hit major financial institutions and prompted an exodus of foreign firms, are expected to trigger a deep recession in Russia, with the economy contracting as much as 10% this year.
Hey, look now at the financial markets. A bloodbath on Wall Street as shrinking profits of retailers renew fears inflation is hurting American companies. The Dow losing over 1,000 points, while the S&P 500 plunged 4%. Both had their worst day since June 2020. The tech-heavy Nasdaq, meanwhile, dropped 4.7%. The declines came after Target's first quarter profit fell by half, and the company warned of a bigger margin hit on rising fuel and freight costs. Target shares fell nearly 25% after its report. Over in Europe, stocks were also in the red, with inflation concerns on top of mind of investors. London's FTSE fell over 1% after inflation in the UK soared to a 40-year high of 9% in April as food and energy prices spiraled. And here in Asia, markets were mostly higher after data from Japan showed its economy shrank less than expected in the first quarter. Philippine shares also extended their rally for a third straight day as investors look ahead to the central bank's Thursday meeting.
The Philippine Weather Bureau declares the start of the rainy season in the country. PAGASA says the declaration is due to severe thunderstorms that brought widespread rains in the past few days. The agency says intermittent rains due to the southwest monsoon or the habagat will now begin to affect Metro Manila and the western sections of the Philippines. The ongoing La Nina phenomenon also seemed to affect some parts of the country. PAGASA adds this may increase the likelihood of above normal rainfall conditions in the next months.
On to our SEA Games updates. The Philippines stays unbeaten in basketball. The Gilas men's team thrashed Singapore 88-37 for its third straight win. They will face host nation Vietnam on Thursday. The women's team also defeating Thailand 97-81. Philippine athletes also continue to rack up medals. Siblings Pia and Abby Dubaure and Phoebe Amistoso clinched gold in the archery women's team recurve. Johan Chua aced the men's nine-ball pool singles for the country's second gold in billiards. Kayla Richardson clocked in 11.60 seconds to also grab gold in the athletics women's 100-meter dash event. The Philippines now has 37 gold medals in the games. Manila is at the third spot in the medal tally next to Vietnam and Thailand.
Congratulations to our athletes, Nikki. And that's the rundown today. I'm Mike Navali. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Head Start comes your way next. Stay with ANC.